Ibrahim Al Hadid. I am HADID. I am a professor of surgery in the Faculty of Medicine. I used to be the Dean Faculty of Medicine and the General Manager of Aleppo University Hospital, and previously Al-Kindi University Hospital as well. I have
spent plenty
of efforts for along 12 years, and I have invested plenty of the money of this people in this country to build that hospital. I have left it by the end of 2012 in a bad situation. It's about 800 beds. This hospital provides the services to about 50% of Aleppo people in all specialties of surgery and medicine.
So
in all specializations.
And what happened after the occupation by the moderate rebels?
Has been attacked by an army of terrorists. And we have many martyrs being in that hospital, being lost their lives. After this hospital being liberated by the Syrian army, I went to this hospital to find no hospital. Gathered stones here and there, covers of medical equipment's been thrown. Nothing. It's very sad that if you see that place, you see the depth of crime. The depth of crime of this attack.
It was the medical equipment of it.
Was it being stolen? Probably moved to different countries, to different places, even to sold it as a thieves or to use it for their purposes. Imagine that someone in Hanover or in Hamburg or somewhere carried gun machines and mortars and came to the center of the town saying, we don't want your government, we want to throw it by force, without any law, without any consideration to any human principle. If you don't come with us, we will kill you. If you were to the government, we will kill you.
Well,
is he a moderate rebel, or he is a moderate opposition? In the last year, after the agreements of ceasefire and low tension in many areas, things improved. In spite of the terrorists, they are not committed themselves to this. If you look to that side, which is the west, the terrorists are about 1.5 kilometers from the center of this hospital.
1.5 kilometers, okay.
They can throw shells and how in any minute they want. And they are doing that on a regular basis.
Still
doing that on a regular basis. And they don't differentiate between innocent civilians, police who are regulating the traffics from fighters.
Yeah.
They threw their shells everywhere without any criteria of committing themselves to any rules or to any agreement or to any ceasefire talks or these things. And the media, and probably all of the human or international organizations, when they came to this area and judged things, it's politics decisions, it's politics conclusions. It's not a reality on the ground. In 2013, 14, 15, I was the manager here in the college as well. The same situation. The city under siege, no diesel, no electricity, no bread, no medications, no spare parts for medical equipment, no x-ray films, no catheters, no contrast materials.
Zero.
We have managed IV fluids, antibiotics, antimicrobials. We have managed ourselves by own ways, in our own reserve stores, in our own ways, we have managed to manage all of these casualties.
So, but for the future, you know, we can't change the past. But what are the needs, concrete needs for the future?
The future is it's by the hands of the foreign governments, especially the Security Council, to lift off the sanctions from this country, on this country.
Could you please give us special...
It's only unilateral measure taken by U.S. and influence Europe. Take it off.
First of all, economical sanctions in the north of this country, if you need an MRI machine, for example, for the doing medical imaging for the brain, plenty of the injuries are in the brain and the vertebral column and the neurological system. You can't import it. Even if you have a machine and you want to import a spare parts, you can't. This is one example. Secondly, the economical sanctions deeply affecting the system, especially the health system. Chronic diseases, cancer diseases, very difficult you are managing to import or to find these medications to our patients. Even dialysis machines. This is, I'm talking about the health system.
Mm-hmm.
So if the country, the countries who are members of the Security Council, especially the US, especially Britain, Germany, need to lift sanctions on this country. It's illegal. It's against the international law. I don't believe they are caring about too much about the international law. Mm. I don't think so. I'm living among people in all of their sufferings.
Yeah.
I'm one of them.
Well, I understand.
In 2013, 14, 15, we don't have even electricity. We look to our each other on the candles in our houses. If you find a candle.
Mm-hmm.
And they claim that those people are the terrorists and the armed rebels, and those people, they're claiming that the government are doing siege on them. When the East Aleppo areas being liberated, if you get inside their stores under the ground, you find the most sophisticated medical machines. You find the most high quality medications of everything.
So they had to get
there. They don't give the people who took them as human shields. They don't even don't give them bread and rice unless they fight with them. That's the reality of the situation. I mean, this hospital has two roles. We are training the postgraduate doctors to be specialists, and we give services. In the war, most of our work shifted to the primary care of the war casualties, and we have managed, let me say, comprehensive statistics about 70,000 war casualties in the last 5 to 6 years.
And the number of children?
In the statistics I gave you, in 2016, exactly about 29,000 war casualties, among them 4,500. This very, very unfair war on this country, launched on this country. It's a well-programmed plan to destroy the heritage, to disintegrate this country. It's not a matter of someone who wants a correction movement, it's not a problem of someone who want to do some sort of political, let me say, political better situation is not, it's a matter of well programmed destruction to the heritage, to the country, to this, to great, this country, and put it 500 years back.